other settled. Friends, today is 133 Friday group meeting. The speaker is V. Mohana, Senior Advocate, and earlier occasion also she addressed us. That is 55th Friday group meeting. The topic was specific performance. We uploaded her video in our channel. Highest viewers she attracted, 6,100 viewers. Entire 77 videos. Yeah. The overall viewers we have as on date, 82,724. Wow. Friends, the topic is, today's topic is 498A and 304B of IPC and presumption under section 113 and 113B of Evidence Act. Mohana, yes. It's a 45 minutes of speech. Yeah. We have liberty. You can split over to part 2 also. Yeah, depend upon situation.
Yeah, I get the
point. One by
Seshu, of course, knows every one of you here. He's been doing this human service of spreading knowledge, which is the most important thing for anybody. Learning and also giving it to others is a great, a noble act, which Seshu has been doing. I am calling him Seshu. Actually, he is Mr. Seshagiri Rao. So I keep calling him Seshu. So, taking the liberty of calling him. Thank you, Seshu, for giving us this opportunity, because you have made us all read and study a little bit more on any topic, every topic that we have to come here, either for listening or for talking. It makes us read and learn more about a particular topic. Thank you all for being here. See, today I chose this topic of 498A of IPC and the 304B, coupled with the presumptions, provisions in 304B, along with 113A and 113B of the Evidence Act. These provisions, I'm sure that all of you don't need any introduction as far as these are concerned, because every junior from that level till this Supreme Court seniors level, all of us have dealt with this topic at some point or the other. Except that when we were reading this provision for preparation, I realized that there is a lot to be seen in these provisions, and we should understand why these provisions were brought in. Somewhere in the day-to-day routine and doing all these cases regularly, we sometimes lose touch with the basic provisions as such, and what is the purpose and the object of the provision and how it has to be interpreted is very important. In the present day scenario, though all these enactments have been brought in beginning from Dowry Prohibition Act 1961 and thereafter these amendments in 1983 and 86 and even criminal law amendment till recently are happening to protect the rights of women, we have also seen equal rising in the case of abuse of all these persons. So I think we should know, as lawyers from this side, from the woman's side as well as the other side, we should know how to interpret these provisions and this, how this court has interpreted it over a period of time. I'll try and limit myself to certain particular thing. I will try to introduce you to certain findings and observations given by this court in matters which have been decided. See, initially, Dowry Prohibition Act came in 1961 for prohibiting giving or taking dowry. We can actually, Section 3, 2, 3 and 4 of the Dowry Prohibition Act deal with this. Section 2 actually defines what is dowry. I will not take you to completely to the dowry. I'll just give you an idea. Section 2 of the Dowry Prohibition Act actually gives what is the meaning of dowry and why it should not be given, and what is the punishment for dowry is Section 3. Penalty for giving or taking dowry is under Section 3, which is the punishment is actually not less than 5 years and with fine, which shall not be less than 15,000 rupees or the amount of the value of such dowry, whichever is more. Let me clarify, they have always distinguished that dowry is different from sridhan. Dowry is the money which has been given in consideration of somebody getting married to a woman. It's called dowry, whereas sridhan is something voluntarily given to a woman from the side of the parents or by the relatives at the time of marriage of a woman or thereafter also. So we can never get confused between sridhan and dowry. While sridhan is permitted, dowry is prohibited. So in every case, we have to find out what exactly is being given, is whether it is a case of sridhana or it's a case of dowry. So we have to go by these definitions given about what is dowry, and Section 3 defines the, gives the penalty. Penalty for demanding dowry is Section 4. Penalty for giving or taking dowry is Section 3. So this much we know about Dowry Prohibition Act. This came in 1961. In spite of this Prohibition Act, there was a huge menace about dowry and deaths relating to dowry, and also suicides as well as murders happening. Unnatural deaths were happening, whether it was suicide or murder, it was not a natural death. So therefore, the Parliament thought it fit that it should be, there was no 498A those days in the IPC. So in 1983, by way of an amendment, the Parliament introduced section 498A of IPC, and a separate chapter was dedicated for that same, 20A was introduced in the IPC. 498A talks about what is cruelty. Along with that, let me read 498A, because that is the main subject that we are dealing with today. Whoever being the husband or the relative of the husband, this is very crucial, because I will be telling you what is a relative of the husband who can be actually charged under this section 498A. Whoever being the husband or the relative of the husband of a woman subject such woman to cruelty shall be punished with imprisonment for a term which may extend to 3 years, and shall also be liable to fine. For the purpose of this section, cruelty means any willful conduct which is of such a nature as is likely to drive the woman to commit suicide or to cause grave injury or danger to life, limb or health, whether mental or physical, of the woman, or harassment of the woman where such harassment is with a view to coercing her or any person related to her to meet any unlawful demand for any property or valuable security, or is on account of failure by her or any person related to her to meet such demand. So 498A was introduced to curb the cruelty meted out to a woman, and by which women are forced and driven to death. There is this, when you read this section, relative of the husband of a woman, then when it comes to cruelty, it says it is the woman. The woman is the person who has been subject to cruelty. Therefore, if a person, a husband or any relative of a husband, by his deeds, word or by actions, if he drives her to, by way of demands of dowry or any other actions, if he drives her to death or commit suicide, then this, he will be liable to be charged under 498A. In this section, what you have to see is only the cruelty which has been mentioned here. It is not actually has to be a dowry. A cruelty in 498A can be actually relating to anything else, not only that of dowry. That's where we have to, because this section 498A is always coupled with dowry death cases or in any other cases. And of course, the cruelty mentioned here is also used as a ground for divorce in other cases, in civil matters where divorce proceedings are initiated. So what we need to now check up is about 498A of IPC, how it is used, interpreted, and how it is applied by the women's side as against a husband or his relatives. This provision, and also along with this came the amendment in the CRPC, because 198A was also introduced by this amendment. 113A of Evidence Act was also introduced. There is a significance, because by 198A CRPC, cognizance of an offence relating to cruelty and was also given to special, when an offence, a cognizance for this offence can be taken, was given out. Prosecution of offences under 498A of the Indian Penal Code, was a special provision was introduced. No court shall take cognizance of an offence punishable under section 498A of the IPC, except upon a police report of facts which constitute such offence, or upon a complaint made by the person aggrieved by the offence, or by her father, mother, brother, sister, or by her father's or mother's brother or sister, or with the leave of the court, or by any other person related to her by blood, marriage or adoption. If somebody is undergoing cruelty, the cognizance will not be taken of a complaint under 498A unless it is filed by a police report, or by the woman herself, or by her parents, or anybody related to her by blood, is a provision 198A, which was simultaneously introduced with 498A. See, once we take up the amendment of what were the provisions, the government wanted to, the parliament wanted to attack and help this kind of menace simultaneously by enacting all these provisions, one in the IPC, another in the Evidence Act by introducing 113A. It is a presumption provision as far as these deaths are concerned. So let me also tell you about 113A. Otherwise, this is, it will not be. So when we are applying these provisions, I think we should know at what point of time all these provisions were introduced. So that will give us an idea as the purpose of when presumption as to abetment of suicide by a married woman in Evidence Act 113A. When the question is whether the commission of suicide by a woman had been abetted by her husband or any relative of her husband, and it is shown that she had committed suicide within a period of 7 years from the date of her marriage, and that her husband or such relative of her husband had subjected her to cruelty, the court may presume, having regard to all the other circumstances of the case, that such a suicide had been abetted by her husband or by such relative of her husband. Drastic, isn't it? Within 7 years of marriage, if a woman commits suicide, then there is a presumption under this section that she, it is actually having regard to, the suicide is actually abetted by her husband or by such a relative against whom there is a complaint. Explanation: for the purpose of this section, cruelty shall have the same meaning as in 498A of the IPC. So what is cruelty for this section, for drawing this presumption, is the same, the definition is the same as that of 498A. So the court thought by, the parliament thought by introducing such a presumption, if, for at least to protect women who are newly married from committing suicide by way of, driving themselves to commit suicide, that offences will reduce by introducing such a kind of presumption, because they will be threatened by these kind of punishments. But that's the intention of the object and reason for this, says that there was a main reasons was to protect the rights of women, and the Dowry Prohibition Act was not sufficient to protect them against all this menace of cruelty and other deaths which were inexplicable. So therefore there is another amendment which also came, which was, this was not sufficient, so it came in 1986. 113B was also introduced, by which in the Evidence Act, presumption as to dowry death was also brought in. When the question is whether a person has committed the dowry death of a woman, and it is shown that soon before her death, such woman has been subjected by such person to cruelty or harassment for or in connection with any demand for dowry, the court shall presume that such person had caused the dowry death. See, 113B, if you see it carefully, when the question is whether a person has committed the dowry death of a woman, dowry death is defined, and it is shown that soon before her death, such woman has been subjected. In a case under a dowry death, which is brought in by 304B by way of the same amendment in 1986, this is Act 43 of 1986, brought in amendment to 304, brought in 304B of IPC and 113B of Evidence Act. By 304B, dowry death, a presumption, and also 113B of Evidence Act brought in this as presumption that whether a person has committed the dowry death of a woman, and it is shown that soon before her death she was subjected by such person to cruelty or harassment. The soon before her death is the crucial aspect of 113B. Soon before her death has been interpreted by this court to say that it is not only actually point of time which is relevant. Sometimes it may not be immediate in point of time, but it could be very much relevant to show what kind of cruelty has been causing her a mental agony which has driven her to commit a suicide. So therefore, soon before death has been interpreted, because always in a case which is charged along with a dowry death along with 113B presumption, the difference would be the soon before her death is not fulfilled, because this, it cannot, it could not have been the reason, a cruelty which has been, there was no harassment soon before her death driving her for a suicide. So this is one section, and I will just show 304B and move on to my discussion. In this, by this very same amendment, 304B was also introduced. So this is also very crucial for dealing with this subject, because all these provisions are always dealt with simultaneously. Sorry, IPC. IPC 304B. Dowry death, where the death of a woman is caused by any burns or bodily injury or occurs otherwise than under normal circumstances within 7 years of her marriage, and it is shown that soon before her death she was subjected to cruelty or harassment by her husband or any relative of her husband, or in connection with any demand for dowry, such a death shall be called dowry death, and such husband or relative shall be deemed to have caused her death. So 304B defines what is dowry death. It has to happen within 7 years of marriage, and it should have been a result soon before her death. There was a cruelty meted out to her or harassment by her husband or any relative in connection with any demand of dowry, such a death shall be called dowry death. So this is the same expression which is carried in 113B. So it has to be in cruelty or harassment relating to a demand for dowry, which should have been soon before her death, in which case it is, and it should have happened within 7 years of marriage, then it is called a dowry death, which shall be deemed, therefore, if that happens, then the husband or relative shall be deemed to have caused the death. And explanation is, dowry shall have the same meaning as in Section 2 of the Dowry Prohibition Act. Whoever commits dowry death shall be punished with an imprisonment for a term which shall not be less than 7 years, but which may extend to imprisonment for life. So this is a very serious offense, 304B. So normally we see in offenses, wherever a case of dowry or harassment or any death before 7 years are occurred, charges are always framed under 498A coupled with 304B, and presumptions are done under 113A or B according to the cases. So when all these came into, came in picture 83, 86 onwards, the object was very, very well known, and it has been discussed in a judgment also. I'll tell you about this. See, now we have discussed, just seen what are the points which are to be satisfied under sections 498A and 304B and all of them. The object actually has been explained in one of the cases. What happened was, when these provisions were introduced, there was a challenge to the constitutional validity of 498A in the Supreme Court. The one of the grounds was that it is, the main ground you can say is liable to be abused, like there is a potential abuse, that this provision can be abused by people who have a grievance against their husband or their family. So, but this court said, just because a provision in of law is misused, or it can be subjected to abuse, that it and it, there is a potential abuse of this provision, it cannot be that we can hold the provision as unconstitutional. And there they discuss the purpose and object and reason. I'll give you the citation. 2005, 6 SCC 281. Two judges, Justice Pasayat and Sema, heard this, and Justice Pasayat's judgment. Para 10 deals with it. The object for which the amendment was introduced is amply reflected in the statement of object and reasons while enacting the criminal law, Second Amendment Act 46 of 83, as clearly stated therein. The increase in the number of dowry deaths is a matter of serious concern. The extent of the evil has been commented upon by the Joint Committee of Houses to examine the work of Dowry Prohibition Act. In some cases, cruelty of the husband and relatives, which culminate in suicide by or murder of the helpless woman concerned, constitute only a small fraction involving such cruelty. Therefore, it is proposed to amend IPC, CRPC and the Evidence Act suitably to deal with effectively not only with cases of dowry death, but also cases of cruelty to married women by the husband, in-laws and relatives. Our object is to combat the menace of dowry death and cruelty. So by this, they say, even if there was another prayer that you can actually issue directions as to how the provision can be well applied, that was said that it can be case to case, it can be decided. So the constitutional validity of this 498A has also been upheld in 2005. And in another judgment in Noor Jahan, 2008, volume 11, SEC, page 55, also the object has been dealt with. A note of caution, 2008, volume 11, SEC 55, also deals with it. There are some These are the two judgments which deal with the provisions object and reason, and the meaning of the cruelty is also explained, and you can use that for a case where you have to explain what is the cruelty in that. Now, there is there was a question which arose actually interestingly whether 498A IPC and Section 4 of Dowry Prohibition Act attract double jeopardy. Because we just saw Section 4 is actually for giving of dowry, there is a punishment. And 498A also is relating to cruelty. So therefore, there was a challenge to that. But it was said it is not correct because Section 4 deals with a situation in a milder form. Whereas if the aggravated form of leading to a cruelty for dowry is dealt with in 498A. Therefore, it is not a double jeopardy. A person can be charged for both the offences under Section 4 of DP Act, also 498A of IPC. That's also dealt with in these, there are some cases in which they've dealt, there is, in fact, that has not reached Supreme Court, it's reached at the Delhi High Court in Indraraj Malik versus Sunita Malik. The Delhi High Court has dealt with this. That a person can be convicted both under Section 4 of the Dowry Prohibition Act as well as 498A IPC, as it does not create any situation of double jeopardy as defined under Article 20 of the Constitution. So that question was also answered.
What's the citation, madam?
The citation, this is actually a Delhi judgment, so I will just give you. Okay. I will give you all the citations that I am going to mention here. Okay. We have noted it down. Indraraj versus Sunita Malik. This is, I think, that is page 4. Deals with that. Probably it's here. 1986 Criminal Law Journal 1510. 1986 Criminal Law Journal 1510 Delhi. There was also a challenge when these provisions came in. There was challenge was about discrimination between 498A and 113A Evidence Act. The argument was 498A does not prescribe any time limit as far as the cruelty is concerned, whereas 113A, that time it was, there was only 113A when the challenge came in, because subsequently 304B also has come in and 113B has come in. So 498A does not prescribe, because the cruelty as far as 498A is concerned is forever. Since it doesn't prescribe, there is a time limit for cruelty to woman. Any time cruelty is attracted under 498A, whereas 113A of Evidence Act, does it's only for 7 years. So there is a
probation.
Yes, they say no, only up to 7 years you take cognizance as far as these deaths are concerned. Whereas in 498A, there is a complete sword hanging through the life. So therefore, they say there is a discrimination between these provisions. But the High Court, they said it was actually a case in a High Court. So therefore, it was held there is a reasonable discrimination of time limit. There is a nexus between the objects ought to be achieved, because this is about the death which happens within. Whereas in a case of cruelty, it's harsh. The death is harsher. So therefore, the punishment contemplated in 113A is different. So therefore, there is a reasonable reasonable discrimination, and therefore there is an object which is, there is a nexus which is established for this discrimination, is what the judgment says. It's 94 Criminal Law Journal 3472. Just out of interest, and to say that these provisions have also been tested earlier is what I am trying to say on these grounds.
What's the page number, madam?
3472. And of course, since we are on 498A, I would say it is a cognizable, non-bailable offence, trial by first class magistrate, and of course punishment we saw from this section. When the 498A provision came in, there was several cases came up in different states. The argument was, today 498A has come, and along with that 113A also has come in. So what about the deaths, which is deaths are only about 7 years of the harassment. 7 years period is already mentioned. So what happens to those cases, whether the provision is prospective or retrospective? That question also came in. But it is, some high courts took the view that they are prospective, but the majority view is that if you hold it as prospective, then the other cases, when the idea of giving benefit of these provisions to people who are suffering, then it will become otiose, is what they say. They say the whole purpose of giving will be negated. It will be rendered negatory is what the other High Court say. This view has been taken by Delhi, Madras, Punjab and Haryana. They say it's all prospective. Whereas other High Courts, majority of them say it can't be, it has to be applied to those 7 year period before the case is filed. That this one, the 113A and 498A will have to be applied, is what they are saying. And when there is a continuing case of cruelty, now let us go to the aspect of jurisdiction. Where do we file these cases under 498A? There is a cruelty which has been started in one place and it has continued. Though the woman moves from the husband's house to that of the parents or anywhere else that she has taken employment, whether the cases can be filed in any place. So there has been judgments in that also. They say actually cases can be filed in a place where when it is a continuing offense, the cases could be filed in an area where the woman is located when the case is filed. Even before that, if the cruelty had started, this is what it says. 2011 SCC 301, Sunita Kumari Kashyap versus State of Bihar, this court has held that in view of the specific assertion of the wife about the ill treatment and cruelty at the hands of the husband and his relatives at Ranchi, and of the fact that because of their action she was taken to her parental home at Gaya by her husband with a threat of dire consequences for not fulfilling their demand of dowry, the Supreme Court has held, in view of section 178 and 179 of CRPC, the offence in this case was a continuing one having been committed in more than one local area, and therefore the one of the local area being Gaya, the learned magistrate at Gaya had the jurisdiction to proceed with the criminal case. See, to say on the side of the defence also, I would say there are judgments to say that actually there are judgments which this court says you cannot file if cruelty is committed in one place. The woman cannot go to another place, and then when there is no such cause of action arising in that area, the case can, the jurisdiction is prohibited, and that magistrate of the local area where there is no offence committed cannot take cognizance. But there are cases where there has been a continuing case and it has gone on for some extent. This court has said exercising 142, we will transfer it to that place, though initially it didn't have jurisdiction due to the actions that have already taken, that under 142 they permit to continue. So that these are all instances. Generally, it is always better to file it in a case where the cruelty has been the cause of action, or little wherever the cruelty has occurred only in criminal law, the situs is that. Whereas in cases of these kind of nature, it has been allowed in certain cases that jurisdiction of cases where the woman is located is also. There are certain cases that I would like to inform you that jurisdiction. Yeah. Rupali Devi versus State of UP. Thank you. 2019, 5 SCC 384.
Say again, ma'am.
2019, 5 SCC 384. This is what this says. The question was whether a woman forced to leave her matrimonial home on account of acts and conduct that constitute cruelty can initiate and access the legal process within the jurisdiction of the courts where she is forced to take shelter with the parents or other family members. Here, they say her sufferings at the parental home, on facts it has been found, though may be directly attributable to commission of acts of cruelty by the husband at the matrimonial home, would undoubtedly be the consequence of acts committed at the matrimonial home. Such consequences by itself would amount to distinct offences committed at the parental home where she has taken shelter. We therefore hold courts at the place where the wife takes shelter after leaving or driven away from the matrimonial home on account of acts of cruelty committed by the husband or his relatives would, dependent on the factual situation, also have jurisdiction to entertain a complaint alleging commission of offences under 498A of the IPC. Though in this case they allow it, they say it will be dependent on any fact situation, why she has chosen another court from where the action actually occurred has had to be determined according to the facts of that case. This is the most recent one, 2019, Rupali's case. It's 36 and 6 also. No? Yeah, this is what I told them, 6 and 36 and 15. This is 142 also, I told you. There is a case where in the case of 498A, though parental home the case was initiated, there was no jurisdiction. I told you 142 was exercised, that's 2014, 12 SEC 362. They have exercised 142 and then allowed that case to continue after holding that the court did not have jurisdiction also. So there are views possible that dependent upon the facts of the case, whether jurisdiction, whether the court where she is not, I mean the cruelty has, was not initially committed there, but she had to move there because of the cruelty, whether those courts could have taken jurisdiction. That issue is also there in 2014, 12 SEC 362. These are about the jurisdiction where these offences can be tried. Now coming to a question whether this offence is actually non-bailable, cognizable, and it is actually not a compoundable offence. Under 320, this offence, 498A, is not a compoundable offence. But over a period of time, law has evolved and this Supreme Court has come to the rescue these kind of cases where, because we see 498A, when it started, it was with an avowed object of actually curbing the menace of cruelty meted out to women, married women, from the family of the husband and his relatives. But what has happened over a period of time is this provision is being abused more often. So the purpose for which the provision was enacted is not actually achieved. At the same time, there are genuine cases. Equally, there are number of cases where this provision has been abused by women. We all of us might have dealt with cases where, I think, wrong, false implication of the husband, of his old aged family members, parents including. So for these kind of situations, when the court, over a period of time, they have dealt with all this, so they have decided and come to the conclusion that there are certain situations where these 320 can be applicable and the offences can be compoundable. There are many cases where husband and wife fight with each other, they result in divorce, and after that, or they may find at one fine morning they forget all their differences and they start living together. So to, if these offences are continued just because they are not, they've been filed at a point when there were disputes between the parties, so the court decided that this is not a case which can be permitted to continue. So to prevent abuse and to meet the ends of justice, the courts have evolved a process by which these offences are quashed and made compoundable. There are at least two judgments where these kind of offences have been done. Of course, Gyan Singh deals with all of them. Before that, B.S. Joshi versus State in 2003, Volume 4, deals with this. 2003, Volume 4, SEC 675. And Jitendra Raghuvanshi also. 2013, 4, SEC 58. Are exactly on this. 2013, Volume 4, SEC 58. So the presently the courts are permitting the compounding and also quashing. Who are all persons against whom this 498A is applied? One we know, of course, husband. Others it says a relative of a husband. So a 498A is not only filed against the husband but also a relative. But interestingly, it has been held that a lady friend or a concubine of a husband is not a relative, and therefore even though those kind of persons have meted out a cruelty to the woman, they cannot be charged under section 498A. It is limited to blood relations. Because there are cases where husbands have friendships with other persons and they also start living in the same house, we have seen, and they start meeting out a lot of cruelty and harassment to the married woman. So she, even though they are criminally liable, but there can be some other cases against them. This 498A is confined only to relatives of the husband and or blood relatives especially. So therefore, husband and his relatives are related by marriage. Cases can only be filed against them as far as 498A is concerned. That's what Suveda versus State holds in the Supreme Court. It is limited to blood relations or relations by marriage.
Suveda?
Suveda. Suveda versus State. 2009, 6 SEC, criminal, 36. And 2010, 1 SEC 618. So assuming somebody has filed a case against her husband and along with his girlfriend, so probably the provision, it says relatives, how much ever may be the relationship, they can never fall under blood relations or a relation by marriage.
As long as, pardon the citations?
Yeah. 2009, 6 SCC Criminal 36. 2010, 1 SCC 618. Vijeta Gupta. Suveda is one case. Next is Vijeta Gupta. Yeah. Vijeta Gupta versus NCT. NCT Dill. Yeah. So what are the instances of cruelty? This is about persons we have seen against whom it can be filed. What is this? So cruelty is said. What is cruelty? What are the instances of cruelty that this court has said? Is that first thing, very surprising but interesting, is that an extramarital affair of a husband is not amounting to cruelty, is what this court says. In most of the cases, when the relationship falls through, probably there is a other person in the life of the spouse, so there is an extramarital affair, so that cannot be termed as a cruelty, is what this court says. In fact, in a case where a person was charged under 498A, read with 306, that's abetment to suicide. 498A is harassment and cruelty. They say that even though it is shown that an extramarital affair was there, she was driven to suicide, this can never be the cause of a cruelty. It can never be termed as a cruelty which has driven her, because this is a decision that she has herself taken. It can never be said that out of this cruelty that she has committed, therefore the offence of 306, they said, was not made out. I'll just tell you about this case, age 35. There are two of them. Vaseem versus State, which is the more recent one, 2019, 7 SEC 435. Here, the case was that the husband had an extramarital relationship which ultimately drove the wife to commit suicide. So they were charged and convicted under 498A and 306 IPC. The appeal filed by the appellant, the husband, was partly allowed by the High Court. He was acquitted for the offence under 306. The conviction under 498A was upheld by the High Court, even acquitting him from 498A also. The Supreme Court has held this, that cruelty, conviction under 498A IPC is for subjecting a woman to cruelty. Cruelty is explained as any willful conduct which is likely to drive a woman to commit suicide or to cause grave injury or danger to life, limb or health. Harassment of a woman by unlawful demand of dowry also partakes the character of cruelty. It is clear from a plain reading of 498A that conviction for an offence under 498A can be for willful conduct which is likely to drive a woman to commit suicide or for dowry demand. Having held that there is no evidence of dowry demand, the trial court convicted the appellant under 498A for his willful conduct which drove the deceased to commit suicide. The appellant also was convicted under 306 IPC as the trial court found him to have abetted the suicide. Section 306 provide for punishment with imprisonment that may extend to 10 years. There should be clear mens rea to commit the offence for conviction. So therefore it says the active act or direct act which led the deceased to commit suicide seeing no option, and this act must have been intended to push the deceased into such a position that he or she committed suicide. So to attract the ingredients of abetment, the intention of the accused to aid or instigate or abet the deceased to commit suicide is necessary. So therefore they say, though there is no demand of dowry soon before the death, the High Court had held the prosecution had proved the dowry demand. So therefore this was set aside. The conviction is not, the conviction has been set aside and the appellant was acquitted of both the sections 498A and 306 also. There is one more on this aspect, is that on this extramarital affair alone there are two judgments, and saying that it's not in itself a cruelty but it should be of such a nature to drive her to commit suicide. Nevertheless, the court says it can be a ground for divorce. A mental cruelty, which can be a ground for divorce. Whereas, that should be distinction. That's the distinction they draw. What is a ground for divorce may not be a ground cruel for a criminal case to be established. So, 2017, 11 SEC 176 also deals with this.
Name title.
2017, 11 SEC 176, KV Prakash Babu versus State of Karnataka. Similarly, when there was nothing in the suicide note about sister-in-law, brother-in-law and family members, they were all acquitted, and lot of cases are there, but these are the main judgments on this, whether, you know, on cruelty, it's one instance. Then again, we have what is cruelty has been explained in a case Manjuram versus State of Assam, which is 2009, volume 13, SCC 330.
2001?
2009, volume 13, SCC 330. So they discuss. 845. They say, because every case actually is decided on the facts and circumstances of these things. We can endeavor to say that there are certain type of judgments of this kind and that kind also. What we can say is, in the facts of that case, a harassment or cruelty is made out or not made out. Because these are all mainly subjective, a relative term for somebody. A mere taunt may be serious enough for, you know, driving one person to commit suicide. Whereas for some of them, they are very sensitive, they can be very soft. But whereas some of them may take it in their stride and then say they may retaliate in a different manner. So therefore, a subjective and a relative term it is. So it is interpreted at by way of, you know, surrounding circumstances and evidence of the local area people or the family members or their subsistence or their continuous writing letters. There are cases where they regularly write to the parents. In those days, there were a lot of letter writing. Now we have WhatsApp and emails also. So there are cases where you prove by subsequent conduct or by surrounding circumstances and the way in which it has been dealt with, that is how one can prove. It's a very relative term. So they can only, they've defined this term in several judgments. This is only one of them, Manjuram Kalita, that's what I said, versus State of Assam. Manjuram Kalita.
Kalita
versus State of Assam. Here, 498A is explained in paragraphs 21, 27 and 28. You can say that it says that very limited, I'll read only one. Cruelty for the purpose of 498A IPC is to be established in the context of 498A IPC, as it may be different from other statutory provisions. It is to be determined, inferred by considering the conduct of the man, weighing the gravity or seriousness of his acts, and to find out as to whether it is likely to drive the woman to commit suicide, etc. It is to be established that the woman has been subjected to cruelty continuously, persistently, or at least in close proximity of time of lodging the complaint. Petty quarrels cannot be termed as cruelty to attract the provisions of section 498 IPC. Causing mental torture to the extent that it becomes unbearable may be termed as cruelty. So therefore, it is a consistent and persistent act which results in ultimate cruelty. Then, of course, we all know that cruelty in these criminal angles we saw, and cruelty is a ground for divorce, that we have lot of illustrations. We have cases on divorce also, like cruelty as a ground for divorce. If you all want, I can give you those citations. The Vidya Vishwanathan versus Karthik Balakrishnan, that is, they have given all illustrations about cruelty. It's 2014, 15 SCC 21. Similarly, we have Naveen Kohli versus Neelu Kohli, 2006, 4 SCC 558. Suman Singh versus Sanjay Singh, 2017, 4 SCC 85.
This one, can you repeat?
Sorry. First is 2014.
Correct.
15 SEC 21, Vidya Vishwanathan versus Karthik Balakrishnan. Next is 2006, 4 SEC 558, Naveen Kohli versus Neelu Kohli. Next is Suman Singh versus Sanjay Singh. 2017, 4 SEC 85. They are all cases of cruelty as a ground. The last case, it was dismissed because they did not accept there was enough cruelty. So people who are defending a diverse case on based on cruelty can make use of this judgment where they have discussed about this. There are a lot of instances of cruelty which has happened. It is always in a case where dowry death has happened. In 304B, these sections are applied in criminal cases. They are all invoked. A bride burning is a dowry death. We have seen a lot of cases in a death which has occurred in unnatural circumstances. Again, 304B. The presumption is that unnatural is neither it has happened within 7 years, and there is no explanation as to how she has died. There are cases where parents don't even come to know how suddenly this woman has died, and it is not shown to be a case of suicide. In those cases also, if it is a case of within 7 years, then presumption has been extended and 498A also has been accepted. There are a lot of instances to that effect, and there are some cases of explaining meaning of cruelty. That's what when I was saying, it's a relative term. What constitutes cruelty for one may not be cruelty for another. So there is no straitjacket formula for explaining cruelty for a particular case. And the sporadic incidents over a period of time, 3 years, 5 years, some instances where we all have petty fights at home, sporadic incidents can never be called as cruelty. Suppose I go and tell my husband today I want to go for a movie and he doesn't accept, it can be one of those. I may take it seriously, but he may not really take it that serious. So it can be, for me, it can be as if a company which is denied because he is enjoying a cricket match or something. So these are a culminating effect that can happen over a period of time, may amount to a sort of cruelty, but it's not one of these kind of as frivolous as this. According to me, it's a very frivolous thing, but for some people it may be very serious. So therefore, it's a very relative term and for cruelty. So therefore, there is no straitjacket formula that has been evolved. And there are cases where the deceased have written letters. There is a case where one of the deceased had written continuously about there has been harassment in the house and I am not treated properly. But subsequently, her own sister, she got her married to one of the relatives of her husband. So in that kind of circumstance, when she died subsequently, she committed a suicide. This court says, see, when she has actually, she's been suffering a harassment, rightly or wrongly, she's been forced, we do not know under what circumstances she's got her own sister married to this family. The mere marriage of a sister into this family will not absolve this husband or the relatives, as if there is a condemnation and therefore there is no offence committed. So there is one such case that though that she has been writing, but since she has been getting married and the same family, is all these are all instances that they say there can be. This is one case where it is held to be a cruelty and the dowry death was there. Secondly, there are cases where a second wife treating the first wife with cruelty. Here they have held, yes, she is considered a relative of the husband because there is a marriage. One is blood relation, another is marriage. So therefore, here she has been held that liable under 498A. The complaint was held to be maintainable. And a case where wife ran to the, in her anger, fit of anger, she ran to the railway track to end her life. There, the case of 498A of cruelty was established, but 304B, he was acquitted. So every case of 304B actually may not result in an acquittal under 498A. There can be offences which are charged under 498A read with 304B of dowry deaths. But a dowry death may not be, there can be no soon before death, there need not be a dowry demand. Whereas a cruelty could have been meted out. So therefore, a mere acquittal under 304B doesn't ensure an acquittal under 498A. So all that we can, when there are people who are charged under these two, when we are faced with a situation under both the, we have to defend all of them, we can probably think of a better situation to handle this, a lesser punishment in the course of time. We can try and attempt to make out a difference that you have not made out a case under 304B. On the other side, I am saying, yes, though for a woman, it can be there are false cases also. Any woman who is affected by a lot of mental agony over suspicion. A woman suspects so much about the husband, about his social relationship with a lot of people, then she drives herself, she commits suicide. In this case, the husband is not even aware that the wife is feeling such a, she is feeling so dejected about his behavior. Here, the husband is not even the cause of her death. So these are circumstances where we can point out by way of evidence and distinguish there is no case as such, there is no harassment, there is not a case, and these are all mental abilities of a person to deal with a particular situation or to tackle. So there are instances that we can either use it in the defense side or in the offense side also. When we are faced with 498A or 304B for a client, then we should actually try and see whether there is evidence enough, because we are now in the third or the third level that we will be dealing with the case. So we have to look into the entire evidence to see whether the offences, we break up the section in this manner and see whether this all the conditions are satisfied, so that we can point out to the court. It's not actually you are dismissing my SLP. It's in toto. It's not correct, because it's 498A may have been made out by one letter of dowry demand or something, but whereas 304B is something more grave. And it has to be made out soon before the death. There should have been a demand, or even she was put to a lot of harassment to that extent. So we can distinguish and argue these kind of cases. And there are cases about there are bail. There is a big problem with 498A and other offences today that we are facing, is that it is very serious. The entire family is implicated. So when we go for bail, there is a big problem. We are normally getting a bail in all these offences. It's very, again, court to court it differs, and the seriousness of the offence, that is, bail is not granted at times, and in a similar manner, though there may be an offence, another court may grant a bail. So there are certain guidelines issued by the Supreme Court in Arnesh Kumar. State of Bihar. Thank you. Arnesh Kumar versus State of Bihar. 2014, 8 SCC 273. This deals with bail and conditions of anticipatory bail.
Madam, pardon the citation.
2014, 8 SCC 273. 273, sir. Yes, no problem. This was a case of husband applying for anticipatory bail for an offence under 498A, and he approached, it was denied. He came by way of a specially petition. In that, this court has evolved a lot of guidelines, and then it says, in an endeavour to ensure that police officers do not arrest the accused unnecessarily and magistrate do not authorise detention casually and mechanically, in cases under 498A IPC, the court gave certain directions. However, the directions apply also to other cases where offence is punishable with imprisonment of not more than 7 years, which include, there are certain directions which are given, police officer not to automatically arrest them. They should satisfy themselves about the necessity of an arrest. Then police officer shall fill a checklist about this under section 41(1)(b) of CRPC and furnish whatever is the reason and the material necessitating such an arrest. Magistrate will authorize detention only after recording its satisfaction on the report furnished by the police officer. The police officer failed to comply with the directions, they will be liable for departmental action as well as punishment for contempt of court. Failure of the judicial magistrate to comply with the directions will render him liable for departmental action by the appropriate high court. So, punishment also ensues as far as the police officer is concerned, also the magistrate, if they don't take care as to when they have to be arrested or not, that aspect. And that is one aspect on bail. Another one is about quashing. What happens, do we have to really go through the entire trial in a case where we are falsely implicated, or in a case where the family has come together after all the fights and after a mediation, if they have come together but the cases are already filed? So there are many instances where they go happily, or they part ways. There are children involved. They don't want this problem to escalate to a different level. So therefore, at some cases, at some area, they all meet with one issue in mind, that they want to part ways happily also. They need not come together, but at the same time, all these criminal cases are still hanging on their head. So on these, there are cases for quashing, whenever there are cases filed against family members, and if the court comes to the conclusion that they are falsely implicated, or there are circumstances which warrant, like in a case of compounding also, a quash is permissible, and the directions have been given by the Supreme Court that these cases can be quashed in Preeti Gupta versus State. There are certain directions.
Which is State?
Preeti Gupta versus State of Jharkhand.
Citation.
2010, 7 SEC, 667. Recently also there is a judgment, it is only in the online, it's not come in the SEC, Rashmi Chopra and others versus State of Uttar Pradesh. Here also, they have quashed the complaint under 498A and Section 3 and 4 of Dowry Prohibition Act. However, there are certain offences under 323 against the husband, so that was not quashed. This 498A was quashed. Yeah. So there are certain directions issued in this as to when a matter can be, complaint can be quashed. Now, going to Section 304B and introducing you to that, there are three occasions relating to dowry in 304B. One is before marriage, another one is at the marriage, and third is after the marriage. So we saw what is 304B. It's a dowry death defined, in which they say there are three occasions relating to dowry. Yeah.
Do we have? 4 o'clock.
4 o'clock.
Yeah.
Okay, then I'll just tell you in two lines that in case of 304B, its burden is on the prosecution.
No, you can split over to four.
We'll do it.
Yeah. That could be the better amendment.
Yeah, main ingredients only I'll say in two things is soon before her death that she was subjected to cruelty, that I've already told you. Soon before death is not defined, but interval should not be much. Existence of approximate and live link between the effect of cruelty based dowry demand and the death. If it is remote, then there is no consequence. That's what they say in 304B. There are several occasions where they have said and given guidelines about unnatural death of a young bride, what all happens. And in case, you know, Justice Kurian Joseph goes to the extent of saying the death was unnatural, it was not explained, it was not a suicide also, but the parents were not even informed about the death and the cremation had taken place. So Justice Kurian Joseph says it should have been a case of 302 and he issued notice why an offence under 302 was not actually put. And also I wanted to tell you, when they are charging, even if there are certain cases where 306 or 498AA are not charged, they can still be punished for that offence. That is also one of the, you know, a law that has been held. So there are several circumstances under which the court has evolved over a period. And I think finally what this court had held is that Manav Adhikar, there is a judgment which they say, in fact, however cases under these matrimonial offences have to be dealt with, there are certain guidelines which were given in Rajesh Sharma by a two judges bench of this Honorable Court, which was finally overruled, that because the two judges bench in Rajesh Sharma said, gave certain directions amounting to actually legislating, that is, there should be a committee in the local area which should look into the complaint and all that. It was almost legislating and taking away the powers of the statutory authorities. So this court in 2018, 10 SEC 443. Social Action Forum for Manav Adhikar versus Union of India. They gave guidelines as to how to systematically monitor and systematically review incidents of violence against women under 498A. So this, with this note, I end this discussion. We'll meet again for a discussion on this whenever the time permits for both of us, all of us. Thank you very much for that.
One second.
I can type it and give it to you. Okay. There are three notes, so we'll combine it and give it. I must thank my juniors, Nikita Kapoor and Ankita Sharma, and all my interns who are presently working. They helped me a lot for preparing for this discussion. Nikita is also present here.
Thank you very much, Mohana.
Thank you.
Very extensively you have given them an elaborate. Mind-boggling, in fact, I mean, such a vague thing. Only thing we can give, I mean, such a standing ovation.
Oh my
all
God.
Men senior advocates we have given. Women lawyer.
No, no, please. Yes. Thank you very much. I'm very overwhelmed by this reception.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. I'm really
so
overwhelmed
nice,
and touched by the gesture.
Now question answers, Amen. Yes. Any questions, please, Amen.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah, please.
Huh? Question answer.
Yeah, yeah, please. He's asking first. Yes. He's asking. Take him. Second year. Yeah, please, quickly.
Ma'am, can I ask? Ma'am, for presumption under section 113B, whether court can presume merely on the allegations by the victim or his family members, or there must be something concrete on the